Bug goes in, invented, or made for the first time, a new type of tower that was based on a parable. So a jet of water running around his own axe, a parable of revolution, 365 degrees, 360 degrees, and then he crowned it with a very original, also very shocking pinnacle, a way to finish, a finial, a tower. For centuries, they used to place crowns or crosses or a figure of the apostle. For example, these towers, like the ones in the other side and the ones in the south, they are dedicated to the apostles. So another architect to work quickly and to finish it as quickly as possible could have said, okay, so I place this apostle or this other apostle. But Gaudí had this idea that when you make the things common or typical, then nobody pays attention. While when you make something that makes sense and is also different, new, then the people is more captured, more eye catch by this new thing. And as we will see when we continue walking, you will appreciate how such a shocking different pinnacle, a set of polyhedra all together like a kind of cubistic tutti frutti crystal that still is on the grow and open on the top like a flower. And while it's a kind of abstract composition, colorful abstract polychrome composition, at the same time it has been said that there it is included the attributes of the bishop, the ring that in the old times they used to kiss, the tiara, this kind of funny hat that opens on two sides, the baculus, this staff that's kind of curvy on the top, and the processional cross. All these four elements concentrated then in a very original manner. And what is also different and very original is the very same number of towers. For centuries, there used to be two. Like we have the typical image of a church, of a facade, Notre Dame de Paris. While here, there are four. And it will be a total of 18. So 12 apostles at each facade, south, east, west. And then above the apsis is rising the Tower of Mary. And in the crossing of the two naves, it's a set of five towers. And now almost they are reaching the height of these apostles, 100 meters, but will raise more higher, 150 for the evangelist, and raising above the rest, embraced by the four towers of the evangelist, the one of Jesus Christ. That will be the highest point, Barcelona. And from the cross, three-dimensional cross, so one, two, three, four, five arms, will be projecting from there some light that the people will see from miles and miles and miles away. Well, these towers, that they are part of the Nativity facade, they begin with a rhomb for a better, more sound standing the ground, but then they turn at the height of the apostles that they are sitting there by halfway, they turn into a circle, the ground plan. But all together in elevation, as we were saying, it's a parable. Here we can see that they have claws, but there used to be a groove that the people used to throw coins. And we have read Templo Expiatorio of the Sagrada Familia, Temple for the Atonement. All these basic differential belief of Catholics versus Protestants. Catholics, they believe that giving alms for charity or to build churches, then if you give money to the church, you get the indulgence. Your sins will be forgiven, expiation, atonement. On this lower part, it has more a downward movement. It is kind of dripping, but it is also combined with an ascensional movement. And altogether, Gaudí had the ability to create this kind of living buildings as would be still growing, kind of tectonic architecture or a melting down architecture, as it would be a giant piece of work. Also very original in the way he designed a new type of cloister. Normally for centuries, the cloisters, so they were attached one of the sides of the church, an open squares that the monks or the canons, the citizens, sometimes they were walking around, sitting down. But Gaudí said for this modern church that in the times already by 20s, they were running through some cars, he said will be a bit nonsense to make a typical classical cloister. Let us surround the church with a kind of buffer corridor, and here's what you can see, these pediments, these gables, that they are at the side, right and left of the main portal, Faith, Hope and Charity, by the way, the dedicator. And again, you can see how useful was that Gaudí was able to finish part of the church, like 15%, all outside, inside it was nothing. When Gaudí died, it has been completed by 90s onwards. So right and left to the main entrance, you can see two of these gables that they have the same tone of the stone as the other one, as the centerpiece. That's because it was complete in the times of Gaudí. And it has been very helpful because 50 years after Gaudí made this small base, that's going to be part of a kind of corridor surrounding the whole church, then the architects, they had it relatively easy to know what Gaudí wanted because they had the model there, right there, not even small in the plaster, but already finished. And therefore, the different tone of the stone. So right, the third one is the new, but copying the one of Gaudí, and left, you can see that they have been adding three more. That also, as they were built recently, they have a much more clear tone because the stone has not been dirtied by pollution. Another of the particularities of the Sagrada Familia, as you can see all over, the height or more in the lower parts, is that the church is all perforated for a better entrance of the light, some beams, natural light, as well as, for example, in the towers, for a better spreading of the tall bells. So when a tower is quite close, always there is an exit, no? But if you perforate it all over, so the sun comes out in a better way, Gaudí very wisely, he put these kind of slabs, so the holes of the windows, the upper part especially, that progressively gets more thinner, all pyramidal wise. There is a continuity from bottom to the top of this kind of triangular shape. So in the lower part, with these slim windows and in a round arch, a thin round arch, that would be a reference to the Romanesque of the churches of 11th, 12th century. And just above, when there is a sentence saying sum sum corde, high with the heart. And then when there is this kind of hut, the pinnacles, this white color, now already for some years until they find the way to properly restore, covered with a net. So some of these small pieces of Venetian glass. So Venetian glass for a better shining, as God would create, God would touch his creation. And this place of interlinking between heaven and earth. So it's a piece of this pinnacle, it's a piece of concrete fastened with an iron bar inside. Gaudí was more like a traditional architect. He didn't use concrete for the most of the building, only in the pinnacles, and also sometimes for the pavement, for the floor. But the thing is that all is rubber, these pinnacles, these kind of cones, open with a flower, with a technique of the so-called trencadís, the ceramic break. But not any kind of ceramic, clay ceramic, but even more expensive, nicer, with coal. So you take a glass, another glass, but quite almost melt, or in the moment of starting to melt. And then is when in between, like a sandwich, you place a golden leaf, and so the golden melts and integrates into the glass, and is when you have these very beautiful light effects in a sunny day like today. So where there is these doves, cypress tree, the tree of paradise, chosen ones, that they are welcome to the house of God, right and left, you have this kind of band going downwards and all together making a kind of triangle, and then above another triangle. And if you draw a line in between these top flowers, that they look like flowers, also again you draw a triangle, so a progressive triangle. And if you look at the different small sections of the church below, always you have this step progression, so pyramidal wise, bringing the regard to the gaze, projecting it upwards, or at the same time that God descends to us in a smooth way. And yeah, the slabs making like a little roof for the openings in between the vertical nerves of the towers, they are placed downwards. So for the sound of the bells, the waves, that they project not horizontally and get lost, doesn't reach the people, but that they are reoriented downwards to reach the ear of the believer. And even for the rain, when it's raining, inside the snail staircase, helicoidal. It's kept dry because these little stone slabs, they splice the water upwards. And what it was able to perforate it so much, thanks to this very virtuous parabolic shape, that is like a freestanding arch, more virtuous like the pointed arch or the round arches that always you have side thrust. The parabolic arch, the virtue it has, that it brings the thrust all vertical down, so he could avoid buttresses, flying buttresses, or also he could avoid the use of thick walls and therefore more perforated. The facade is also somehow beaten by three cones that they give this hollow to the three portals, faith, hope, and charity. The central one and the side ones, it's kind of blurred by so much decoration, angels, the Holy Family, and other figures, and even letters, the rosary. But really, if you would take out all the sculptures, you would clearly see like an invisible cone that has been beaten in the stone and draws this generous hollow to favor a smooth entrance of the gaze into the church. Now we are looking from the Avenue Gaudí. That is quite an exception in the very chessboard display of the streets of the new town, that they go like from the mountain to the sea, and they are crossed perpendicular by other streets of the same size. This street is obliquous, and it's perfect to see the Sagrada Familia from this more northern part, and a part of a very brilliant street light from Pere Falqués, with this kind of mix of curvy lines and over decorative motifs of the Art Nouveau and wrought iron great works, with some kind of gothicism that matches perfectly the sharpness of the Sagrada Familia and these great marriages they were doing then between stone and great works of wrought iron. We have a medallion with a fish, the profile look of Gaudí when he was in his 60s, 65. And from here we can see the evolution of Gaudí's architecture. Left, parabolic, like film, as put on the field with air. But the other ones on the right, the last geniality of Gaudí, the last style, the so-called ruled surfaces, because he was able to make all these strange forms out of straight lines, despite altogether looks like hollow and warped, really all was made with very simple display straight lines. So the bars, the iron bars, or the stone pieces that they are flat, and together they draw a straight line, or also pieces of brick. These other towers we can see over there, they have these hollows in between the vertical sections, like the nerves. It's like a kind of sharp, hollowed Brunelleschi tower, a kind of orange squeezer, a sharp orange squeezer, or an umbrella when you start opening it. It is the contrary as the ones, the older ones, based on the parable. It is as the parable has been suffered an inner aspiration, so the walls they get inwards. And the upper windows, elliptical, but also with this trumpet shape, hyperboloid. Very different from the first windows he was making. This lower part, still in a neo-Gothic shape, pointed arch. Then when he was older, he discovered that when he made the windows with this hyperboloidical shape, like the end of a trumpet, and then inside the other end, the light goes through more smoothly and distributes inside in a more homogeneous, smooth way. And the lining inside, as you can see when you enter, is one of the things that make the church more special and create a different type of religiosity. So the virtue of all this architecture is not to see the mass and to see the grandness, or even to see the decoration that is very worthy by itself. But he made all these new inventions, new towers, new type of windows, a new supportive way with a type of column he invented, a tree column that is like a kind of arm with the hand and the upper fingers, many hands and many arms to support a ceiling that is half flat and half bolted to free the outer wall from any supportive function, and therefore the wall is, as we were commenting, very perforated. So in this view from the northern part where there is the apsis, it's perfect to see the evolution of how this architecture and design and discoveries along 50 years from 1881 until he died 1926. When he was younger, so right and bottom pointed arch, quite original, especially by the gargoyles, that there are a series of reptiles and kind of disgusting animals as they are expelled from the church, representing like evil. But then when he was already his 35, 40, he was more sound about, more sure, and thought he was better from a static point of view, structural, but also for his beauty, with a parabolic arch. And you can see here that still they have to continue with this base to make a cloister. It's built with a parabola. It's not really a round arch, and neither a pointed arch. It's a parabolic arch, or a kind of jet of water. And then, as we were commenting, as he continued his study and his research, then he was inventing this hollow, warp, hyperbolic paraboloid. You see, both the St. Mary's big tower, now 150, but we raised like 100. No, now it's 100, we raised like half more, 150. As this other one, sacristy, that Gaudí left it quite finished, small, and then the job of the architects by 2000 was to build it like 10 times bigger. Yeah, so in between the nerves that they come out, vertical nerves, in between there is this hollow surface that is a so-called hyperbolic paraboloid. So parabolic arches or leaning columns, other architects, they had experience with it, but really he was the first to experience, together with Chukov, a Soviet engineer, but it was more for towers in the Air Force, more civil architecture, engineering, but Gaudí was the first to use it for architecture. This wedge, this kind of Pringle potato, or a saddle of a horse, these surfaces that they go like convex, but at the same time they go concave. You don't really, it's hard, no, to see whether it goes inwards or it goes outwards. Has this virtue of flexibility. You can see the triangles really there in between. You can see the straight lines. That really they are the ones who build the structure of the dome. And these very generous windows, always trumpet shape for a better entrance of the light. Now here we are walking through the north side. At each corner is signified by these little chapels or a sacristy. And then here that will be on the lower part covered by seven bays of the cloister, this kind of surrounding corridor that will give this buffer zone in between outside, the noisy outside, and inside it is much more peaceful and silent, even for the believers before sitting down in the main nave on the banks to hear mass. So it will be a way to get ready, walking around like in a procession, getting ready, and then finally sitting down. This little roof that now seems like a roof, but will build the ceiling of the next bay that will build right here. It shows perfectly the shape of the hyperbolic paraboloid. Ruled surfaces, because they are surfaces made out of straight lines that they are placed on a straight line that is ruled. For example, a snail staircase, that is very helpful to understand what means the rule surfaces architecture. To make a snail staircase, you have a vertical straight line, and then you put the steps progressively, one higher than the other, going around this vertical line. So each of the elements, the steps, that also they are straight, and the vertical axis, all they are straight, so very easy for the architects or for the laborers to keep putting them. But all together is helicoidal. So the same to make this kind of orange squeezer, umbrella shape, new futuristic Brunelleschi domes. So we have this combination of two types of towers.